We have an outstanding scientist this year as our keynote speaker. Katharina Riedl got her education at the Technical University in Munich, and from there on she had a very international training before she ended up where she is right now. She did a postdoc in Denmark and returned back to the Technical University, always being very much interested in bacterial, microbial infections and understanding the mechanisms behind them. She was a group leader then at the University of Zurich, and then she moved to the Technical University in Braunschweig, where she was a professor for microbial proteomics in the Institute of Microbiology. And then in 2011, I think, she moved to the University of Greifswald, to the Institute of Microbiology, which she became then director of. And she is there heading a really internationally competitive proteomics facility, very much focused on microbial infections and mechanisms, but state-of-the-art technology with and focused on the most fundamental questions. Since that is not enough for Katharina Riedl, she volunteered to become vice dean of the faculty of natural sciences in 2016, and she meanwhile became vice president or vice rector of Greifswald University and takes care of the research activities in at University of Greifswald. And since that is not enough for Katharina Riedl, she just recently became elected as the new rector of the University of Greifswald, and she will start this very important position in April 21. We are so thankful that she is here because she is a member of our scientific advisory board. And so when I learned that she is the new rector of the, she will be the incoming rector of the university, I immediately asked her, I assume you will not be available anymore for us with having so many commitments. But no, what a surprise. A few minutes later, I got the answer, no, I will stay. It's fun. And she will stay in the sciences and will be interested and helpful for us. And this is particularly important in times when we have to make strategic decisions. You just heard from the president, from President Fulda, when we really want to streamline our efforts with the other Schwerpunkte at Kiel University. I think we need advisors of the caliber of Katharina Riedl. With that, I welcome her and would like that she starts her talk entitled Metaproteomic Approaches in Infection Biology and Microbial Ecology. Thank you very much, Katharina, that you are here. And I think you have to upload now your talk, or your talk is already uploaded. I don't know, but I'm very much looking forward, as all KLS members, to your presentation. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you very much for your kind introduction. I try now to share my screen and I hope it works. So it's really a pleasure for me to give you an overview on the potential of metaproteomics to solve important questions in infection biology. And I have to admit, we have also been involved quite a lot in microbial ecology. I'm also a member of the DFG panel, microbiology, and there I'm a member as microbial ecologist. So you will hear about infection biology, but also about microbial ecology. So I have here an overview on the topics I would like to talk about in the next hour. I will give you a brief introduction into the potential and into the challenges of metaproteomics. I think that's important for you, especially for those of you who would like to employ metaproteomics, maybe for their own research questions. So we'll also talk a little bit about the technology. And then I would like to illustrate this more theoretical part of my talk by a couple of projects from my own research. In the first half, I will talk about infection biology. So we have been working with biofilms and more recently also with microbiomes. And later I will talk about these more microbial ecology projects dealing with wastewater, lichens, and in the end with marine particles. And I would like to finish my talk with some take-home messages, especially for those of you who might plan to employ metaproteomics for their own research. So as a microbiologist, I have been used to work with model organisms for several decades. In my case, especially with Staphylococcus aureus, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, Clostridioides, Difficile, and E. coli. But we all know if we are working with these organisms under lab conditions, it has nothing to do with the real challenges these organisms have to face in the environment or during an infection. That brought us to the attempt to work under more clinically relevant conditions. And that was started by growing these organisms as biofilms, especially Staph aureus, Pseudomonas, and also Clostridium. Nevertheless, also growing biofilms in the lab is quite artificial. We use these flow-through systems, which are quite handleable, but also far away from the reality. And this was then the reason that we started to employ metaproteomics now almost 15 years ago. Metaproteomics is also called community proteomics or environmental proteomics. And it's really the point that you extract the proteins directly from the environment. And we have been working with many, many different environments, marine ecosystems, fresh water, leaf litter, soil, but also this, we call it human habitats, such as the human gut, for example, or biofilms growing on implants and catheters, and so on. Now, metaproteomics enables us now really to address the central questions in biology. Who is out in the environment? What are the organisms doing? Why are they doing it? And how are they doing it? And I'm really fascinated from the potential of metaproteomics, but I also have to admit that it has some limitations, that it should be combined with other omics technologies. And I would like now to spend the next minutes to talk a little bit about the limitations and the challenges we have to face employing this technology. First of all, no matter what kind of sample you're interested in, I would say the worst case is soil, but also infection models or body fluids or also mixed cultures that you have been growing in the lab. They're all highly complex. That means that you have to deal with highly complex protein mixtures, and that raises a lot of problems. First of all, it's not so easy to really identify the proteins because you need corresponding sequence information. And you have not always metagenomics or metatranscriptomics information available. And the second point is that in many cases, we only cover the tip of the iceberg. For example, if we're investigating soil samples, we might cover the metaproteome for 5 to 10%. Maybe it's better if you have not so highly complex biofilms. Here you reach maybe a 50 to 60% coverage, but still you do not see the entire story. So one could now question whether this is helpful, but we will identify the most abundant proteins in the samples, which might also be important if they are so abundant. So I would still say that it makes sense to perform this metaproteomics analysis. Now, in order to come to other challenges and problems, I would like to give you a brief overview on the workflow that we are normally employing, starting with the extraction of proteins. Then we try to reduce the high complex samples by either chromatography or STS stage, and then digesting the proteins, either in solution or in gel, and are then performing tandem mass spectrometry with the resulting peptide mixture. And in the very end, we are using this mass spectrometry data for database searches and data analysis, data integration, and interpretation. And you probably believe me if I tell you that not the mass spectrometry is the difficult step here in this analysis, but it's on one hand the protein extraction. You have to deal with highly diverse samples, and it's really worth to invest some time to optimize the extraction protocols. And the largest challenge is certainly the database search. And why is this the case? First of all, we have to deal with extremely large databases. Database of a bacterial monoculture contains maybe several thousands of proteins, whilst in a metaproteomics approach, you are dealing with databases that contain more than 10 to the 6 proteins. This is on one hand increasing the computational costs and searching time. Sometimes we are searching for 1 week or more. We increase the number of false positives, and we have a lot of redundant subsequences in the databases, which also causes problems. And that's something you probably know. We can only identify proteins that are really present in the database. That means that you, in the best case, try to construct a database based on metagenomics or metatranscriptomics data. If these data are not available, you can extract proteins from general databases based on the knowledge which organisms are present in your samples, for example, by sequencing 16S RNA genes. Or you have to go into the literature and anticipate which organisms you have to expect, but I can warn you, do not search in general databases. Meanwhile, they are so large that most of our bioinformatic tools cannot handle them. And as I already said, you have a lot of false positives, et cetera, et cetera. So try really to construct a targeting database. We have a second problem, namely that if you have a very complex protein mixture and a large database, that our mass spectrometry data do not fit only to one protein in the database, but sometimes to many proteins which are closely related. That brings us to the problem of the protein grouping. So we have a group of proteins that, and now you have to decide which is the right protein. So what we are normally doing is that we are searching for the smallest common denominator with respect to the phylogenetic origin and the functional group the proteins belong to. You can imagine that this is not possible to do this by hand. Therefore, it's really extremely important to employ sophisticated bioinformatics tools. And we just published a protocol in Nature, a manuscript in Nature Protocols. If I'm talking about we, it's my former co-worker, Stefan Fuchs, now located in Berlin, and colleagues from Magdeburg, where we suggest to employ a workflow consisting of the so-called metaprogram analyzer, then a program profane. And for the visualization, you can, for example, use the so-called PAVER software. And I will come back to this in a minute. Now, before I'm talking about visualization, I would like to briefly mention how we quantify proteins in these complex samples. I think that the gold standard is still the so-called normalized spectral abundance factor, where you simply count the spectra that can be uniquely assigned to specific proteins in your sample. You can normalize this data based on the protein mass. You can imagine that there's a higher chance to detect peptides of a larger protein compared to smaller proteins. And you can normalize the data based on the total number of spectra. And these values are reliable, but nevertheless, there are quite a rough estimation of the abundance of the proteins in the samples. If you would like to get more accurate, you need to calculate actually the area under the mass spectrometry peaks. However, the software packages that are available so far can deal with complex samples, but not complexity is limited, so to say. So for example, if you would like to work with soil samples, which are highly complex, you still have to stick with the NSAF values because these software packages, which are more accurate, are not working in these cases. Now, the last part of my introduction is now addressing the visualization of these complex data sets, which is not so easy. You can imagine you have thousands of proteins and you would like to get a quick overview of what is really happening. And there, the PAVER software is a very nice tool where you can really get a very quick overview on the phylogenetic origin of proteins, but also on the functional distribution of the proteins. And I will briefly explain you how this tree maps, as they're called, are working, because you will see these tree maps later in my talk all the time. Now you can distribute proteins or also genes. You can use this also for transcriptomic data into different functional groups. Here the level is quite high. You can, for example, distinguish between lifestyles and metabolism. And then you can go into smaller categories with respect to metabolism, for example, carbon or amino acid or nucleotide metabolism. And you can then go down to the level of single proteins or single genes. You can also map the expression level into these tree maps. And I show you now one example. Actually, it's the proteome of Bacillus subtilis. And you see now the protein expression along the growth curves. And you see proteins in orange that are increased in the expression rate if you compare two time points, and proteins in blue if they're decreased. Now we are following the growth curves, and you can easily see how the expression profiles changes depending on the time point. And in the very end of this growth curve, you, for example, see a high expression of sporulation and stress proteins, and a low expression of motility and protein biosynthesis proteins, which perfectly makes sense. With respect to phylogenetic distribution, I also show you how you can depict now data over a certain time period. These are now samples collected from February to June in the marine habitat. And you can now see how different phylogenetic groups are distributed. And also here you can go down from a very high phylogenetic level down to the species level, and you can really follow the abundance of the organisms along this time period. So far, so good. Now I would like to give you some examples, and I would like to start with a little bit older project where we have been dealing with oropathogenic biofilms. These biofilms are growing in casitas, and many people that have to carry these casitas for a longer time have severe problems. The latest, after 10 weeks, these casitas need to be exchanged, as sick microbial biofilms are growing and really blocking these casitas. And these can have severe consequences: inflammation, blood infections, bladder and kidney stones, up to bladder cancer. And we have been working in a consortium that was interested in developing casitas that prevent or at least slow down the formation of biofilms. Now, the questions we wanted to answer were, first of all, who is present in these casitas, and how do the inhabitants of these casitas adapt to these harsh environments in the bladder? We also wanted to know how the organisms interact with each other in the casitas, and most important question, actually, how the human immune system really reacts to this normally asymptomatic biofilm growth. That means that the patients have no symptoms in the first weeks until the casitas really get blocked and need to be exchanged. Now, here an overview on the experimental design. We were collecting the casitas together with the urine drainage bags. We were actually extracting proteins from the biofilms at the casita tips and from the urine. We were also extracting DNA for 16S RNA gene sequencing to validate the metaproteomics data, and we were isolating material from the biofilms and grew them in artificial urine medium as biofilms. Compared this also with planktonic cultures, but the most interesting comparison was finally to compare the in vitro protein profiles with the in vivo protein profiles. The next picture just depicts how we grew the biofilms. It's actually flow-through systems that consists mainly of a lot of tubes. And we exchanged some of the tubes simply by the casitas that were also carried by the patients. Now, if we are looking on the taxonomic composition of one example of these casitas, you can see there's a high number of human proteins in the biofilm, certainly also in the urine, but there are also some bacterial proteins. And in our example here, proteins of Pseudomonas aeruginosa, Morganella morgani, and bacteria In the urine, we only found the two aerobically living organisms, Pseudomonas and Morganella. And we were able to validate this distribution of proteins by the 16S RNA sequencing and also by the cultivation and subsequent sequencing of the organisms. Now I show you the overlay of the in vitro and in vivo data, and you can easily see that there are some orange and brownish proteins which are strongly expressed under in vivo conditions. And if you now look on the functions of these proteins here for Pseudomonas, you can see that there are proteins involved in defense mechanisms, biofilm formation, and what is very obvious, many, many proteins involved in iron acquisition, which tells us that iron is a highly limited nutrient in the bladder environment. A similar picture now for Morganella, the second dominant organisms. Also here, the proteins are involved in defense mechanism, in certain metabolic functions. If you dig deeper into the data, you will also see that the two organisms follow a bit different nutrition strategies. And also here, we see a lot of proteins involved in iron uptake. Now coming to the human proteins, about 10% of these proteins are actually involved in innate immunity. And we have been now asking ourselves whether these proteins are always present in the bladder environment or whether they are now specifically expressed in response to the presence of the microbial biofilms. And to answer these questions, we were actually comparing the protein profiles in urine of three persons carrying the CDUS and three control persons. And as you can easily see, these immune proteins are strongly expressed, especially in the patients, which tells us that this is really a specific answer to the presence of the biofilms. Now, with all this information, we can draw a quite detailed picture of the interactions within the biofilms, but also the interactions between the host and the pathogenic biofilms. And just to name a few of these interactions, the host is, for example, expressing lactoferrin. Lactoferrin is able to bind iron. This lowers even the iron concentration in the bladder. And the bacteria react by producing proteases that are able now to degrade lactoferrin. So it's kind of a ping pong game between host and pathogen in order to fight for the nutrients. And maybe another example, now the interaction between Pseudomonas and Morganella. We see that Pseudomonas is able to express receptors for siderophores, so iron binding molecules that are produced by Morganella, and that it's expressing bacteriocins that are actually able to kill Morganella. So if we would follow these biofilms for a bit longer time, I would expect that Pseudomonas aeruginosa finally outgrows Morganella morgani. So far, so good. Now I would like to continue with a second story. That's a project that has been financed in the frame of the so-called Landesexzellenz Initiative in Mecklenburg-Vorpommern, a project which is called CoInfect, where we're working together with the University of Medicine, the Friedrich-Löffler-Institute at the Island Reims, and the University of Medicine in Rostock. And the project deals with unraveling pathomechanisms of bacterial co-infections. And as we are working together with the FLI, we have the opportunity also to employ large animal models and are mainly interested here in swine. On the left, you see the organisms that we are employing for these monocausal or co-infections, among them streptococci, staphylococci, and the virus that we are using is influenza A. Now the experimental design, we have a primary infection always by the viral agent influenza, and then after a few days, the secondary infection with the bacteria. We are comparing this infected animals for sure with healthy control groups and are then following the entire infection over 30 days, analyzing the health status of the animal models, looking on the immune reaction, and that's our task, actually investigating how these infections are changing structure and functionality of the microbiome. We are interested in two microbiomes, first of all in the lung microbiome, but also in the intestinal microbiome. And our task was, as you can assume, the metaproteomics part. We have partners that are also working on the 6 in sRNA level. We have partners that are looking at the virome, and we have partners that are doing metabolomics. And the idea is that we, in the very end, integrate all this data in order to get a holistic view on the changes in the microbiome. Today, I'm not talking about the infection microbiome. As a starting point, we have been questioning how stable actually the microbiome is over the 30-day of infection period and how much it varies between the animals that we investigate. And I will now show you results from the microbiome analysis of the large animal model swine, and we have been starting with the intestinal microbiome. First of all, we established a workflow where we can handle the samples for all the different omics approaches in a very similar way. We are doing this analysis from one and the same sample to be able then in the very end to integrate the data and to visualize them together. Now, some numbers. We were able to identify more than 1,000 species, bacterial species, more than 20 virus species, more than 5,000 protein groups, and more than 80 metabolites per sample. We also asked the question whether feces is really approximate for the composition of the microbiota of the colon. And we compared therefore samples from the ileum, the proximal and distal colon and feces. And as you can see here on the 6S RNA gene level, the samples of feces and colon appear to be very similar. So we can really work with feces. Now I'm coming to the results regarding the microbiome structure. Here, the comparison of the 6S RNA profiles and the metaproteomic data, which looked actually quite similar. We also saw a specific dynamic within these different phylogenetic groups that is quite comparable if we look on the 6S RNA profiles and the metaproteomic data. And we saw, at least for me, surprisingly low variations between the different animals that we were investigating. It looks actually a bit different if we now look on the functions. Here the variation is really small. If you look on the scale, we depict here differences from about maximum of 3%. So on the functional level, we see a quite stable microbiome. And now if we map our proteomic data to the metabolome data, you see here actually in light blue all the metabolic pathways that were covered by the metaproteome analysis. And these colorful dots are the metabolites that have been identified. And fortunately, all or nearly all the metabolites were really matching to the pathways that were postulated to be active based on the metaproteomics data. Now if we look at bit more in detail on the metabolome data, you see here, for example, the short-chain fatty acids that have been identified over the 30 days period. And also here, this is comparable to the metaproteomics functional data. The variation is relatively small. And that's something that is even better to see on this NMD plots. If you look now on the squares B and C, on the top you have the the phylogenetic distribution, and on the bottom the function distribution based on the metaproteomics data. And you see really some shifts in the phylogenetic distribution, but relatively stable functions. And to sum these first story up, I have to say that we were able to establish this quite robust, actually, analysis pipeline, that we could characterize the intestinal microbiomes very nicely by comparable data set based on the 6S RNA sequence and the metaproteomics, that we also saw these similar longitudinal dynamics in the composition of the microbiome, but that this changes are not reflected by the functional categorization, And all of this points to a kind of functional redundancy in the microbiome. And this data set is now a very nice basis for all the data that we meanwhile have obtained for the infected animals. We are, as you can imagine, it's really tons of data where we are currently in the stages of analyzing and also integrating these different omics data sets. With this, I continue now with the part where I'm talking about microbial ecology. And the first project I would like to talk about is somehow at the border and deals with antibiotic resistances. I guess all of you know that there's really an enormous problem, the increase in antibiotic resistant bacteria. There are estimations that in 2050, 10 million of the infections are deadly infections, actually are caused by antibiotic resistant bacteria. And that is a problem that also the BMBF has really addressed. And some of you might know this consortium, Infect Control 2020, which exactly deals with this problem. And the Institute of Microbiology was heading one of the consortia of this Infect Control initiative called Antires. And the goal of this project was to investigate how antibiotic resistances are distributed via wastewater. I think you all know the problem. There is kind of a misuse of antibiotics in human medicine, but also, especially in veterinary medicine and also in agriculture, antibiotic resistant bacteria can get via wastewater into surface waters and are then really high risk for humans and also for animals to get reinfected. And we were mostly interested in these mechanisms that are really getting these antibiotic resistances, not only the bacteria, but also genes and proteins from the wastewater into the surface waters. To this end, we have been sampling two different wastewater treatment plants, one in Göttingen, one in Greifswald. We had also the advantage here that we could directly sample behind the university hospitals, so sample water that is where we have really a high risk of antimicrobial resistant bacteria. And then we were sampling the two wastewater treatment plants prior, during, and after the cleaning process. And we were not only sampling water, but we were also sampling primary activated and digested sludge, and did this four times a year in order to also investigate whether temperature, moisture, etc., has an influence on this distribution process. The samples were then comprehensively investigated with respect to the phylogeny of the bacterial community, with respect to resistances based on metaproteomics analysis. We also counted the colony-forming humids, so the total bacterial load. And we were also quantifying the antibiotic-resistant bacteria. And there was a group in Berlin, actually, that helped us with the biogeochemistry. So we're investigating the amount of antibiotics that went into these wastewater samples. And in the end, we had a nice overview on the organisms, the pathogenic potential, the resistance potential, and the antibiotic load of the samples. I'm starting with the classical microbiology, so to say. We were counting antibiotic-resistant bacteria in all of the samples. And to make a long story short, this is also only one data set from one time point. We could really detect antibiotic-resistant bacteria in all of the samples, albeit for sure the number of these antibiotic-resistant bacteria was significantly decreased if we looked at the outlet of the wastewater treatment plants, and that's what you would expect. Some of these antibiotic-resistant bacteria were further characterized, for example, one of the multi-drug-resistant E. coli strains, but due to time limitations, I cannot go into detail here. Now, if you look at the bacterial communities, you can really distinguish three clusters. The samples prior to the treatment, then the treated samples, and One cluster is only one sample, so to say. It's a digested sludge, which is characterized by anaerobic conditions. Now, if I look a little bit deeper into the samples, you can see here the very similar pattern of samples derived from the hospital, the inlet, primary treatment, and primary sludge. Then the second group, activated sludge, the effluent of the wastewater treatment plants, and then the river at the bottom, in which these cleaned water was then filled in, and then the very end, the digested sludge. And even looking a little bit more in detail into the samples here, the untreated sample, you can see that there are a few dominating groups. Arcobacter, Acinetobacter, for example, it's an Acinetobacter. There are many typical gut bacteria present in the samples, which you would expect, but also quite a high number of potentially pathogenic bacteria, especially if you look at the hospital outlet. Now, coming to the treated samples, here we have a much higher diversity, and we have many bacteria that are typical environmental bacteria and known to be present in activated sludge. And finally, here the digested sludge, where you see a few highly dominating groups, Methanotrix, for example, Methanolinea. And this is a typical picture for anaerobic samples. The most interesting part now, the antibiotic resistant determinants that we could identify within these samples. As you can see, the number of these proteins is decreased if you compare the untreated and the treated samples, but nevertheless, you find a diversity of resistance-associated proteins in the treated samples, especially also in the digested sludge sample. And to sum the story up, we can really show that antimicrobial genes and proteins are still present after the entire cleaning process. And what we also observe is that in the untreated samples, these resistant genes and proteins are mostly found in potentially pathogenic bacteria or members of the gut microbiome, while after the treatment, these resistant genes are quite often found in harmless environmental bacteria, which points to a transfer of antibiotic resistance genes from the pathogenic to the environmental microbiota. So there is a certain risk connected to wastewater and certainly also to digested sludge. And in the next step, we then started a collaborative project with the Leibniz Institute for Plasma Research here in Greifswald, where we tried to establish at the moment a lab scale called plasma-based reduction of bacterial counts. This also includes certainly the antibiotic resistant pathogens. And the second nice effect of plasma treatment is that it also destructs the antibiotic structures. We are in the middle of the upscaling process now. So far we did this in the lab scale with 300 milliliters, which is certainly nothing. But the next step will be to upscale the process. One could think about a fourth cleaning step in the wastewater treatment plants. However, this is probably quite expensive. But one idea that we follow now is that we would like to concentrate on high-risk wastewater. So, for example, on the outlet of the hospital waters. Now I'm changing gears once again and now really continuing with this real ecology projects. And this is a project that Thomas knows already from the graduate school evaluation dealing with lichens. We are working together since, I would say, almost 15 years now with two groups at the Technical University in Graz, Martin Grube and Gabriele Berg. And my colleagues have been working for many, many years with one of the typical model lichens, namely Lobaria pulmonaria. That's a very interesting lichen. It's an indicator of ecosystem health. That means that it's very fragile with respect to pollution. So it's also a protective species. And it's also interesting with respect to medical applications because it produces compounds that are anti-inflammatory and also anti-ulcerative. Now, just to remind you, most of you probably know, but lichens consist of a fungus, the so-called mycobiont. And you can see here the fungal hyphae also here. And between these this hyphae, you find algal consortia, this algae together with cyanobacteria. In this case, I say together with because Lubaria has a photobiont that is composed of green algae and cyanobacteria, not either as it's written here. And then and that knowledge is comparably new. You have here a thick biofilm, so to say, of bacteria at the inner side of the lichen structures. And the large question was in the beginning of our project whether these bacteria are simply there or whether they really contribute significantly to the lichen symbiosis. And I also tell this story because it shows you quite nicely how metaproteomics developed over the years. When we started with this project, it was, I think, in 2005 or so, we didn't have any database available. We had less sensitive mass spectrometers, and you know this workflow already, but with this workflow, we were only able to identify 460 proteins, which is compared to our current numbers, almost nothing. Nevertheless, we could get an idea about the composition of these bacterial part of the lichens. Now, if you look here at the top, you see that the bacteria are actually an important part of the lichen community. They're almost as abundant as the algae. Now, if you look at the bacteria, you can see that the proteobacteria are obviously the most dominant group within this bacterial community. And among the proteobacteria, again, the alpha proteobacteria seem to be highly abundant. So we could also verify that cyanobacteria are part of the Lubaria lichen, and we confirmed, so to say, investigations of our partners that had already been showing via fish that alpha proteobacteria seem to be very abundant in the Lubaria lichen microbiome. Now, looking at the functional distribution, you can see that the distribution here on the top of the bacteria, of the fungi, of the green algae is very, very different. In the bacteria, for example, you find a lot of proteins involved in stress response, while, for example, in the green algae, most of the proteins seem to be involved in energy production and conversion. That also makes sense. Now, a few years later, our partners in Graz were sequencing the metagenome, and this enabled us really to identify much more proteins. We got a much better picture of the division of labor within this symbiosis. However, and that's what I would like to show you, that's quite often the case, that's now here in white, actually, the identified proteins, and in blue, the metagenome, and you can see that the coverage is still really not satisfying. Nevertheless, we detected, for example, that the bacteria produce vitamins, cofactors, growth-promoting hormones, that they seem to protect the lichen against toxins, and that they're also synthesizing compounds or also proteins that are fighting bacterial but also fungal pathogens. So far so good. Now the latest paper that we published, we meanwhile have another data set that will be published soon, is from 2017, and again we were able to increase the number of proteins. Now we have almost 7,000 proteins here in this study. And one idea was now also to compare actually Lobaria samples from different climatical zones and to investigate which changes we can really observe in the microbiome depending on the region where the lichens are collected. With this study, we were also able to actually prove that archaea are part of the lichen microbiome. We could also assign important functions to the archaea. And we found that there is a second fungus present on the Lubaria, which is obviously living from dead material on the lichen. So it's kind of a saprophytic member of the lichen community. Now, this is a very complicated tree map. Actually, I just wanted to show you that you here can now depict really which functions are actually expressed by which kind of members of the community. For example, here at the bottom, you see proteins involved in photosynthesis. And as you can see, these are only produced by the cyanobacteria and by the algae, whilst other functions are like here the ATP synthase, beta unit. This is something that you can identify for almost all members of the community. Now, with all this data, we have now really a quite detailed picture of the lichen community. We see that the bacteria are really significantly contributing essential functions to the lichen community. And they have actually a very similar function compared to our intestinal microbiome, for example. Now, the story is going on. We have now collected lichen samples from all over North Germany and Austria and also Scandinavia. And we have the hypothesis that the microbiome, the bacterial microbiome, is the most variable component when you look at the lichens, and that they are responsible for the adaptation of lichens to this really very different climatical regions. So at the moment, we are also trying to not only perform metaproteins, but also genotypic analysis to get even closer insights in the adaptation process. So my last project I would like to share with you is part of the research, DFG research in Pompu, where we are interested in polysaccharide degradation in marine habitats. There's already a lot of knowledge about polysaccharide degradation of free-living bacteria, but there is an important fraction in marine habitats, namely the so-called marine snow or marine particles. And these are largely unexplored because it's relatively difficult to extract DNA and proteins from these particles. So we had two hypotheses when we started this project. First of all, we are hypothesizing that the communities on the particles are significantly differing from the free-living counterparts, and that these key players on the particles also express very specific functions, because you have really different environmental conditions, there are surface associated, and you have also other nutrients present on the particles. So again, and that's already kind of boring for you, we started with optimizing the workflow. We were actually filtering the samples and we're distributing the samples into the free-living fraction, into medium-sized particles and large-sized particles, and we're then really trying quite a lot of different extraction protocols to really get the proteins out of this sticky biofilm matrix, which is actually not so easy. But in the end, we were able to identify more than 5,000 protein groups per sample. The first question we asked was, how comparable is the phylogenetic composition? And as you can see here on the left, there is a big difference between the particulate fraction and the free-living fraction with respect to the ratio of eukaryotic proteins, which increase with the particle size. And we see also differences in the bacterial community. There are, for example, cyanobacteria, flavobacteria, and some of the protobacterial genera that are more abundant on the particles, whilst alpha, beta, and gamma protobacteria seem to be less abundant on these particles. Now, looking at the eukaryotic fraction, we really see that the number of eukaryotic proteins or percentages is dramatically increasing if we look on the larger particles. This, on one hand, tells us that the interactions between eukaryotes and bacteria on these particles seem to be very important. And it also explains a bit why it's so difficult to really get a better metaproteome coverage, because so far our databases mainly contain bacterial proteins. So we now need to really sequence eukaryotic metatranscriptome in order to get more sequence information and to improve our databases now for the next steps. And I would like to end this little story by showing you the functions that were identified now in red again, free living fractions, and in yellow and blue, the particulate fractions. You can see that there are obvious differences in the composition of glycoside hydrolases, transporters. We see, for example, a lot of adhesion proteins in the particulate fractions compared to the free-living fraction. We see, on the other hand, a lot of motility proteins in the free-living and less in the particulate fraction. And that was also an interesting result. We see quite a lot of antibiotic resistance and also biosynthesis proteins in the particulate, or especially in the larger particles. At the moment, we are now investigating different algal blooms. And here, our group is focusing on the particles from actually samples collected in 2018 and 2020 in order to validate these results, in order to get an idea on the temporal changes along these algal blooms. So that was, so to say, the scientific part. Now I would like to finish my talk with a few take-home messages. I hope I could convince you that metaproteomics is not a standalone technique. I mean, you always need the genomics and, in the best case, also the transcriptomics information on one hand to construct appropriate databases, and on the other hand, when you look on metatranscriptomics data, also to validate your metaproteomics data. And the same accounts certainly for the metabolome data. So in the best case, you either do all the three technologies or work together with sophisticated experts, as we are doing, because I think metaproteomics is a field where you cannot do many things aside. Now, I hope I could convince you that metaproteomics is really providing important information. What we really learned from all the different projects that we have been following, that we are often detecting highly abundant bacterial or microbial groups in different environments, which are then not playing an important role if you look at the functions. So it's important really to not only look on the structure of communities, but also on the functions, and really to know who is doing what. And I think the last slide is probably the most important, coming back to the challenges of metaproteomics technologies. I just recommend you to really invest time in constructing and also collecting data for targeting protein databases. This is extremely important to obtain reliable data. A second important point is that metaproteomics is still not a high throughput technology. I guess that most of the people doing proteomics would certainly agree with me. It generates really extremely large data sets, and you need most of the time for the data analysis, data integration, and data interpretation. So you have, don't do a fishing expedition, but really think about the goal of your study. And this accounts even more if you are interested in quantitative data, as we all are interested in quantitative data. Here you need enough replicates, not only biological, but also technical replicates, to really generate reliable quantitative data. And in the very end, once again, you have to complement your metaproteomics data with complementary approaches. In the best case, you have even phenotypical assays available that you can apply, but at least you should combine these metaproteomics data with metatranscriptomics and metabolomics. And the last thing I would like to do is to acknowledge all the people that have been contributing to the different projects I have been showing you from my own work group, Jörg, Daniela, Christine, Dirk, Christian, Uwe, Maria, Doreen, and Larin, that are partly postdocs in my group, but also PhD students that contributed to the projects. And I have to say a big thank you also to Dörte Becher, who is the head of our mass spectrometry unit at the Institute, who is always very helpful with respect to the analytic pipeline. Last but not least, I would like to thank all the collaborations partners here, especially our partners in Austria and certainly also all the funding agencies. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Katharina. That was a fantastic, a comprehensive and exciting talk.